We begin by taking a page right out of A Christmas Carol. We need Wilfred to do this. Why might you ask? Because all year long, the markets have been seemingly haunted by three ghosts. But this week, we have watched them disappear one by one. First, the clarity that the Fed will keep rates where they are throughout perhaps all of next year. Next, last night's UK elections gave us clarity on Brexit's path forward. No more questions. It's going to happen. And this morning, perhaps the biggest specter of all over the market, trade and relief on a tariff and a promise of more ag buying from China that sent that worry packing. Mostly because, remember, nothing is quite signed yet. So, with these market ghosts gone, effectively, Tim, what the dickens are we to do?
Oh, wow.
I don't even know how to respond to that, especially when
you sounded
so
really
dramatic
smart.
And spooky.
Good job, Sullivan.
Well, look, I think Charles Dickens certainly could have written up a nice tale that led to a happy ending. And you can make an argument we've had the happiest of endings. Don't look at me like that, Brian. So we have a case here where if you think you've removed all this uncertainty, the next question is, where's the market positioned and where are expectations? And you have to say they're extremely high. It's not as if you look at bull bear indicators or AAII or whatever you want to follow, greed and fear indices, and overall positioning, people are grabbing risk into year end. You had a retail sales number that missed. Yes, you had a jobless claims number that wasn't so great. You had a CPI number that was very hot. So people that think that the Fed's out of commission for all of 2020, I think you have to be clear that the Fed is always going to be a data point away from being back in the conversation. So great week. Important week for markets, but a week where I don't think you can just say everything is fantastic.
Maybe. I do feel like, Steve, people latched on to that slightly weaker retail sales number.
Definitely.
And made it a bigger deal. I mean, auto sales were good. They revised October up. It wasn't like the consumer's gone.
The entire market traded off the weak retail sales number. They didn't trade off of the Brexit or trade or Fed, as we just discussed at the top of the show.
We've done that for the whole month, right?
No. Yesterday we traded off of trade. You had the cyclical names, the chemical names, the paper names, all traded higher. You had tech names trade sort of sideways to flat. Today you had all cyclical names trade lower. That means they were paying attention to retail sales versus anything else, which surprised me, to say the least.
So I would say, from my view, it was more a combo of the two. So we had weak retail sales, which people didn't expect. So use that as an excuse or a catalyst to sell. But to Tiny Tim's point, going with the theme of that, I would say people are looking at this deal and saying, My point is, I think the deal, the so-called phase one deal today, I think people took a look at it and said, it's not much different than we've had if there is even any deal there. And so everybody unwound that kind of risk on trade they had. And if it wasn't for Apple, I would say probably the S&P would be down.
You think so? What about you, Jacob Marley?
I don't even know. So here's the thing. I think it's a combination of what you just said on positioning and also sentiment. And I think it's also the calendar, too. So you think about this, since early October, when we supposedly had an agreement on a phase one trade deal, that was the last bout of downward volatility that the S&P 500 had seen. And it's really been a slow grind up for almost 2.5 months now. And here we are off the October lows, about 11%, up 26% on the year, heading into a year that all of a sudden now you think that those headwinds to global growth are taken away. I'm just not so certain about that. I don't have the answers, and I don't know what we traded off or didn't trade off today, but I'll tell you this, it feels an awful lot about like late 2017 into 18, after we got that tax cut in December, mm-hmm. and just the sentiment going into 18. It was really, I mean, we went parabolic. I think we were up 8% in the first few weeks of January, and then we went down about 9-10%, and it took months to get back to those
trade deals.
Highs.
Feeling like Y2K a bit. I mean, everybody's talking about it for months and months and months,
but nothing happens.
What happened? The market, we got a deal, and the market barely blinked. Either two things are happening.
I wouldn't say it.
What?
The market blinked yesterday. The market moved yesterday.
Yeah. What?
The market has moved 15% since October, guys. 15% since October.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, of course it's moved.
I'm talking about on the news. So either it was already priced in from the previous move, or
there's
another leg up when the paper is actually signed, because we don't actually have a deal.
No, I hear where you're going with this, Brian. I don't think this is about, hey, not until the somebody that sings that's particularly overweight. And I don't think we can say that anymore, so I won't.
You just did.
But I think this is a case where you got to it earlier, which is that the markets have rallied since October 3rd when we had that last real kind of dip downward. The S&P is up almost 15% in a straight line. That's a dynamic going into the year end where you have some seasonal stuff. Look, Dan said, the world's not a great place. There's an argument that maybe we found some bottoming. What's different to me, though, Dan, about now between the end of 2017 and 2018 is you have parts of the market that are just starting to pick up steam now. You actually have some of the late cycle cyclicals. You have some of the resource stocks. You have some of the reflation trade, which is what I've been talking about over the last couple of days, that I think have some room to run into 2020.
The key for me, though, is Q1, where everyone sort of, I don't want to say got ahead of their skis. I'm still positive, but I'm positive going into year end. I don't see a hell of a reason to be selling this market in any case, even though there's no sell the news event that you could make on trade because there's other phases that are coming. So you don't want to get in front of that. You've been run over every time you started to short the market. I do think the test is going to be Q1, where we see where estimates are and when reality hits the pavement. That'll be your chance to sell the market. We're not there yet.
Well, just don't fight the Fed.
I guess, ever fight
the Fed and a couple hundred billion in liquidity.
Yeah. So far, that's been the right move. But I think, you know, to Steve's point, we do have a market that is up a lot that perhaps has gotten a little bit ahead of what earnings growth are going to be. So the point is, you better have that global economy kick in. This so-called phase one deal better get CEOs out there saying, hey, you know what? I'm going to spend some money out there. I'm going to build something. I'm going to send some ships around the world. Otherwise, I do think Q1 could be spot on.
I mean, Dan, listen, to BK's point here, it has not just been the U.S. market. I mean, the Japanese Nikkei's finally started to do something. Europe has done well over the last 90 days.
Okay,
Every major index is up.
Okay, think what it took in this mid-cycle adjustment to get these global economies, like, working here. We had 3 rate cuts, and we had the Fed stop QT and start effectively QE. We see it out of the EU. We see it out of Japan. So if that's what it takes to get a 25% return on the S&P 500, fine. It doesn't mean that we've solved any ills that's going on in the global
Dan's
economy.
Right
now. No, I'm just saying, like, I just feel like looking
like
at it through the lens of the S&P 500 is not speaking to these issues. This trade deal is not about soybeans and natural gas. It's about what is this perceived imbalance of trade, okay, since China joined the WTO 30-some years ago and what they've been taking advantage of. That's what this is about. So if you're telling me that you put all of these tariffs in place out of a tweet, okay, you're weaponizing tariffs, and then you're going to roll $10 billion of them back. That's the net differential. Then I'm telling you, it's not a deal, it's not a win, it's not anything. And
it's
if
just
we're not
closing for the market, though. It's semi-closure.
Steve, this is a good analogy, okay? The North Korea deal. Remember the Singapore summit, and he had this thing, and he was going to walk out. It was a huge thing, and this and that, whatever, and nothing happened, okay?
Right.
There's a strong likelihood that we have the same thing here.
I hear you.
That's why I said the paper's
the
not signed yet.
Trade,
I wonder if there's another leg up.
The markets trade on perception and reality and where that middle ground is.
So would you say that a flat
now.
S&P today would tell you that the
no,
perception
that
is that we S&P, may not have anything?
I would say that an S&P up 26%.
But we rallied into that, though, over the last couple months.
But it's up 26%. It's based on a lot.
I don't want to be. Hold on. We're going to get to Josh in a second. I don't want to be the Grinch, but let's not forget. At the same time this deal is being talked about, there's also the threat now, Tim, of bigger tariffs, new tariffs on European goods, by the way. We sell to China
and then we're
about
create,
the same as the GDP. Hold on, about the same of
worry,
GDP
Brian.
Of Delaware.
But we're going to create another wall, and then that wall will be taken over by bulls yet again.
I'm just saying the threat of tariffs where they are is not gone.
So again, this seems to be a tool this administration loves using. They love using tariffs. They love to use trade restrictions. They actually love to use sanctions. These are things that I don't think are particularly effective in an economic sense, from a market sense and from a political sense. And I think this may be what Dan's talking about. Look, winning a trade war that gets soybean deals to states that are very
politically important.
It's
not about soybeans. We know it's about IP. But that's the whole thing. There might be using soybeans and ag and everything else, but it's about IP. Everyone agrees. Both sides of the aisle agree.
Steve,
Democrats
well,
and Republicans
but they started with steel
agree it's
tariffs
IP.
In March of 2018.
Because you've got to bring some. You have no
I
other
know,
leverage,
but
though,
what
man.
Has happened, though, it, now we're here. We're, yeah. We have a deal that's literally just pulling back some tariffs and buying more ag. I mean,
it's about
so,
IP.
But it's a step in the right
the
direction. Okay, guys.
Okay.
Good. It was a good discussion. It's Friday. It's almost Christmas. Take it down.
God bless us all, everyone, Brian.
Everyone. All right.